June Chepkemei is the Managing Director of the Kenya Investment Authority. June, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Kenya's Biggest Conversation.
Thank you. Happy
it's,
to be here.
It's the hot seat of the Situation Room. So, first of all, why are you late? Traffic.
No, there was no traffic in Nairobi, actually. Mm. This is my third meeting of the day.
Okay. So why are you late for the third meeting?
Because I knew that you have to read news at 9. Mm. So unfortunately for you, I've worked in the studio before and I know the programming. So I'm convinced that I'm on time.
Ask and you shall be told.
Okay.
Still.
Okay. So for the next 26 minutes or so, let's have this conversation. Right. First of all, getting straight into it, what is KenInvest, the Kenya Investment Authority?
So Kenya Investment Authority is actually an investment promotion agency that was established by the government of Kenya in the year 2004 to support investment promotion, facilitation, and to support the investment climate in the country to attract investors. Mm-hmm. So we're actually an agency who is mandated with supporting the growth of the economy.
Okay.
Through investment attraction.
And investment attraction, therefore, we mean FDI.
Both FDI, which is foreign direct investment, mm-hmm. and DDI, which is domestic direct investment.
Okay. So on a daily basis, what is it that you do then to attract investment?
First, we package opportunities that are investable, those that investors can look into and put their money in. Secondly, is to take them out there and promote in either forums or through sessions that we have with our investors. And thirdly, we facilitate existing investors by providing them what we call aftercare. We visit their premises, understand what it is that they're struggling with, or if they're looking for expansion, what can we do for them, and collate that information to inform policy. And lastly, we just create awareness of Kenya as an attractive investment destination.
Mm-hmm. Which of those functions and roles do you end up doing most of in a year? If you look at, you know, the number of activities that you've had, is it of promoting, is it of collating and curating investable opportunities, or is it the aftercare and the pre-care for investors?
A lot of it is really facilitation, where we receive investors coming to Kenya Investment Authority to be supported, to register, to get work permits, to get approvals and all that. So for instance, this financial year, we facilitated 179 projects with an FDI.
This financial year, the current one or the concluded one?
So the financial year ends in June every year. So it starts in July to June. So as at June, we had facilitated. And facilitation means you're registering them, helping them set up a company, get them all the approvals, whether it's county government approvals, NEMA approvals, regulatory approvals, even supporting them to get a premise or to set up a factory, until they have presence in the country. So we did 178 projects, and these have a capital outlay of 74 billion Kenya shillings.
So are we looking at this money that comes in over a year, or how? What time period are we looking at? The investment and then now the business activity that takes place for these organizations in the country over a period of time, or is it a one-off?
You know what, that's a fantastic question, because that's where most of us lose the appreciation of what it takes or how long it takes for FDI to land. An investor will set to move into a country with a certain capital investment, and they would then say that you're looking to put, say, $10 million in the next 5 years in this economy or in whichever period of time. Mm. So these that we are looking at is for a certain period of time, maybe at a minimum within 3 years to 5 years, when the investors begin to then see return on their investment. Mm-hmm. So FDI does not land pap the 74 billion. It lands over time.
Yeah. But the 178 projects that you facilitated are already in country.
They're already in country.
But they haven't now fully established and started operating.
So there are different stages of establishment.
Mm. Now, we've also heard that one of the things that you have to do also in basically in attracting foreign direct investment, mm-hmm. is you've got to go into those markets to start dealing with investors in those markets and showcasing Kenyan investable opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
How do you do that? Do you organize road shows? Is it you attend trade fairs in other countries?
Okay. So a majority of the missions are actually organized and you're invited. Sometimes as a country or a ministry is invited. Then we go with opportunities that are either sector specific or reflect what that particular jurisdiction is looking for in a country like Kenya. Most of them are organized and there are no trade shows. Remember, there's a difference between trade and investment. With regards to trade, we have our sister agency called Keproba that then supports the trading and retail aspect of our products.
Mm.
But for us, we go out there to tell them, come to Kenya. Mm. We have a market in Kenya. We have a market in East Africa. We are a market in Africa. And we provide you access to the rest of the world.
Okay.
So when you establish in Kenya, you then begin to produce and take it out, or you can sell it internally.
Mm.
So that's really what we do.
Why is it necessary to do so much hand-holding for these organizations? Does it say something about a system that is not seamless? Because you talked about helping them get this documentation.
Mm-hmm.
Up.
Okay.
They need help to do this, get this permit, get this license. Why would you need to help them out so much?
Think about it this way. Pick a country.
Estonia.
You need to go to Estonia. What comes to your mind? And you're taking your money to Estonia.
Mm-hmm.
What do you do?
I need to buy a plane ticket.
Fantastic.
I need a visa.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
How do you get the visa?
I go to the embassy.
Uh-huh.
And apply.
Uh-huh.
With my relevant documentation.
So when you land in Estonia, what happens? Do you go to Google Map and figure out where do I invest?
Well, the assumption is that previously I've had a conversation with the people that I'm going to
Fantastic.
Start with.
And yeah. That is Estonia Investment Authority.
Mm-hmm.
Chances are.
Mm-hmm.
So when you land in a new country as a foreigner looking mm-hmm. to invest and like a tourist,
mm-hmm.
you then need to go to that entity that points you to everyone you need
mm-hmm.
at one go.
Mm.
That's why we handhold them.
Mm.
They would still do it, but it will take them a longer time figuring out, so where is Kenya Revenue Authority?
Mm.
Can you imagine for a foreigner, even the thought of opening a bank account is tedious, not just in Kenya, anywhere in the world, because you then need paperwork. Where do I get this paperwork and this and that?
Yep.
And then which bank, even just recommendation of which bank will then support me to register. So that is why we handhold them. And the reason we also focus a lot on handholding them is we want to leave a positive taste so they feel that we are welcoming and we are more supportive and facilitative as a country. So it's the impression you also want to leave and encourage them because they feel that they are supported.
Mm. What do you do about the, one could call them few,
mm-hmm.
but any number of negative reviews that you receive
mm-hmm.
by investors who are seeking to invest in this country and set up in country? For example, we've heard at a presidential event mm-hmm. in the former administration, an investor standing up and saying, you know what, I've been seeking to invest in this country
mm-hmm.
for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And I have just been given the runaround by government mm-hmm. officers.
Mm-hmm.
I'm told I need to go and get this permit and another permit. And I start, I'm told, you know, mm-hmm. before you got this permit, you ought to have gotten three other permits.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, just being taken on a runaround
mm-hmm.
and it takes long for them to invest. I'm talking about one that invested recently
mm-hmm.
at Dongokundu,
mm-hmm.
and this is Taifa Gas.
Mm-hmm.
He had spoken in the Uhuru time and said,
mm.
I'm getting frustrated. We've had Dangote try to come here.
Mm.
Oh, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, he just gave up and moved away.
Okay.
What do you do about that? Because that then dents the image of Kenya as an investment destination.
So we have had cases, and some actually are investors that decide to fly to Estonia, they pick a ticket and they fly,
mm.
and then they land anywhere. And that's why we are pointing them to land at Kenya Investment Authority. If you land at Kenya Investment Authority, then it's our job to then point you to Dongokundu. Because what is Dongokundu? The foreigner will Google Dongokundu and pick a plane ticket to go to Mombasa, and then they find themselves in the middle of nowhere. But when you come to Kenya Invest and we are able to to tell you that actually Dongokundu is a special economic zone. So we take you to the Special Economic Zone Authority and we are then supported to land at Dongokundu. Or simply for your kind of investment, we think you should be at Tatu City, because when you are at Tatu City, these are the auxiliary support infrastructure or market or access that will then fit you, or you're supposed to be in Naivasha or whichever part of the country. So the challenge has been, and we have to admit, we have not come out strongly as Kenya Investment Authority to be the one stop, one go center for investors to then avoid this
or
the first port of call, because they end up landing in the hands of consultants or other interest groups that will then end up pushing them around, and it leaves them wondering whether this country is really ready for investors. But let me mention that at least for the few months I've been at Ken Invest, a majority of the complaints that we get are people looking for tenders and people who are trading. Let's face it. And let's love our country enough to speak up and say, you are a trader, you're not an investor. You've spent 2 years in Kenya looking for a tender and you are complaining that you want to invest. That is not an investment. No, that is trading. And of course, retail and wholesale is also a form of, investment attraction. Look at the economy like United States of America. It's purely driven by retail and wholesale. But when you come to Kenya and you're looking to sell to government, and you're not getting that breakthrough, because, selling then comes with different legal requirements. Mm. But then that you conclude that this country is not attractive enough. So we've had also confusion between trading and investment, and we've had to be extremely tough and say we need to be bold and provide red carpet to people who are bringing money to this country, produce in country, sell in country. So if, for instance, you want to sell us gas, we are happy to facilitate you to get a gas market. But first set up that facility in Kenya. Let it be made in Kenya. And we will hold your hand as Kenya Invest and take you to that market and even convince government to provide you with a market so that you can de-risk your investment.
I'm a bit confused. On these matters of business, especially where maths is concerned, I am a bit slow. So okay. I sometimes miss a point. Mm-hmm. Say someone comes and invests, meaning they come and set up a factory. Mm-hmm. That's an investment.
Correct.
Now, when they start selling their whatever it is they're producing, are they not trading?
They're trading.
Okay, so when we say there are people who just come to trade and not invest, then, and you say they're looking for tenders, but I'm assuming that if I set up a factory and I'm selling something, I will still be dealing with tenders at some point.
Correct.
Okay.
So this person,
break it down for me so that I understand. Yes.
And I don't think you're slow. So if you, again, pick a product that you want to invest in.
You want me to pick a product?
Yes. Yep.
That I want to invest in?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Anything I want.
Pick okay. Tires.
Okay, tires.
Actually, I was thinking of tires.
Okay.
Okay, tires. So you walk into the country and you're looking for a market to sell tires. And these tires, you're importing them ready 100% from another jurisdiction.
So what you're looking is to set up a warehouse.
Correct. Here. So what you've done is to set up a warehouse, and we are busy struggling with your custom clearance and A, B, C, D, and D.
So you're not really adding value that we particularly are interested in.
Not necessarily, because all you're doing is to sell.
And anybody can do that in Kenya.
Anybody, any Kenyan can go out there and buy tires and set up a warehouse and sell.
Okay.
And you need to be given preferential treatment.
Oh, so you want preferential treatment because you're bringing tires.
No, you're a foreigner bringing tires.
I don't think we're going to give you preferential treatment.
So, sorry. We have to agree that we are not a consumer. Because we built a consumer economy in this country. We have facilitated markets for products made in other jurisdictions. And we continue to do that. And when government says, no, we are going to levy taxes on this so that those companies can consider doing it in Kenya because it's cheaper, And so you create jobs, then we begin to bash government and say you are killing us with taxes. So maybe we need to interrogate a little bit some of these decisions that are made, because we want to make it cheaper to produce tires in Kenya and mostly expensive to import tires to the country.
It's called protection, and right. I think it's allowable.
Now we are a liberal economy.
Even with a liberal economy, we have to protect our industries.
Now we are together. Next question. I'm happy with that.
Yes, because liberal economy or not, there is no, even the most liberalized economies on the planet protect their own industries.
Good. Mm.
Why should one come to your office as Ken Invest? Must one come to your office as Ken Invest?
Why must one come to my office? Because one, we will provide you with legit opportunities that have been vetted and exist. Two, we will link you with every single part of either government entity or agency that will support you to land. From helping you with that visa to come to the country as an investor, help you with that permit for you to do your business in this country, help you register that company or incorporate it, help you with that license that you need either from a county government or a regulatory body, whether it's IRA or NEMA or CESA or EPZ license. We will point you to where you need to be, and you will cut the time that you will take to land. And secondly, we do it free of charge.
How long will that take?
To do what?
Depends. That entire process that you've said.
So, for example,
I am an investor. I want to come and set up a tire manufacturing factory mm-hmm. in this country. Mm-hmm. Okay. Obviously, as an investor, I've done a bit of my due diligence. Mm-hmm. Is there a market in this area? Yes. Mm-hmm. Maybe if I start from Kenya, mm-hmm. I can sell in the region and mm-hmm. this and the other. What would be the best area for me to do that? Mm-hmm. Everybody's concentrated in Nairobi. I want to go to Nakuru. Okay. So I've done a bit of that.
Mm.
So I come to Ken Invest and I say, I want to set up a factory in
mm-hmm.
this and such area
mm-hmm.
to do tires. I want you to walk with me through that journey. How long, ideally, should this journey take?
First of all, it takes you at a minimum of 2 days to get that permit to come to the country. And it will take you another 2 days at maximum to incorporate your company, because we do it at Ken Invest. We have business registration services there.
Mm-hmm.
That's the maximum. Now we've set you up. You're ready to do business. But then you probably would be looking for either you rent a facility, or you want to buy land, or you want... Actually, you probably need a facility.
Yeah.
So if, for example, you want to do it in Nakuru, we will recommend what as government we can close, which is set up at SEZ Naivasha.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if it's SEZ Naivasha, it's within our control, and within a month, we've managed to get you all the licenses because it's government facility,
mm-hmm.
and we'll give you a rate. We'll be able to support you connect with power, water, and the rest. Now, if you are coming to set up in a private property, we'll take you to that facility, Tatu, then the processes applicable to that private entity is what you will then have to go by. And sometimes you get stuck in negotiating the rates and the rest. That ideally is beyond our control as government. But for those that you have control over, especially if you are setting up either at Konza, or you are setting up at our SEZ, or you are setting at our EPZ, then that we can close within the shortest time possible, depending on what it is that you need. But remember, we need to always get you regulatory approval. For example, NEMA. So if you're getting a NEMA regulatory approval, you need to then appoint your technical team to submit documents.
Mm.
Most investors get stuck there. They either appoint the wrong team or they delay in appointing a team, or they simply are in the wrong site that will then not get approval. Then we get lost in that, and it can easily be translated to mean doing business in Kenya is not as smooth as it should be.
Okay, in terms of the numbers of folks who've come in and then gotten the necessary support from Ken Invest, are those now today viable projects, viable investments, whereby you can point back and say, actually, you know what, because of the facilitation that was provided by Ken Invest, we can see these portfolio 1, 2, 3, mm-hmm. 4, what kind of numbers are we looking at? And can we point to each of them and say that actually they are actually providing something toward the economy and then would serve as a case study for others to come in?
Oh, we have amazing case studies. Visited one of 2 months ago in Mombasa that set up a biscuit manufacturer. You know the value that a simple biscuit factory brings to the economy? First of all, you get our wheat, you buy our wheat, you buy our sugar, you buy our water, and then you then begin to consume our power, you create jobs, and then the logistics, you know, the companies that then buy your biscuits and distribute to the different parts of the country. A perfect case study, and they're now expanding. Recently, we were having a session. We have roundtables with different embassies to just look at the investors. And there's this company that came with them. I think it was Israeli ambassador to our office. And as we were engaging, this gentleman said, "Hey, I came to Kenya. I was planning to set up here and wait for about 2 years to see return on my investment. But I'm profitable in 6 months." Thanks to the support I received, the handholding, I was quickly supported to settle. So we have fantastic case studies, but I need to mention that we are not the only agency that facilitate investors. Why? Because the Investment Act of 2004, which is an old act, removed mandatory registration of investors by Kenya Investment Authority. And therefore, as a country, we may not have total visibility, especially from the Kenya Invest point of view, of who has come, especially those who come through other channels. Please note that there are entities in this country who simply do investment facilitation, structuring, and all that as a business.
Yep.
So some come through those entities, and they are different, but those that at least come through Kenya Invest have had good stories.
So you're saying that our laws have allowed Kenya Invest to have competitors?
Not competitors, because we are the only government agency, but it is not mandatory to register at Kenya Invest. So you can come and Latif holds your hand and tells you, "Hey, I know a place you can invest in my village," and you go invest there, and we have.
And
no,
I do my due diligence, and yeah, I find it makes sense, and I go ahead and invest.
Yeah.
The question though is, does Kenya Invest have some collaboration or network with these other entities?
Good.
Does it open up its doors for these other entities to also come and maybe benefit from Kenya Invest services?
We had before, but we had not strengthened it enough and built the value that will make them want to partner with us. So what have we done? We have come up with the investment facilitation framework, which we are being supported by UNDP and World Bank, to then clarify the investor journey, number one, but create a point of convergence for the partners, in that especially these entities that facilitate, they do structuring, which we cannot do. We don't have that capacity as government, and we would not want to do it. So if we have what you call lead. A lead is an opportunity that has not been structured to investment grade,
yep,
what we call bankable opportunity. Then you come in as a partner and you work with us to structure it. Within the structure, then you have your what you call success fee that you'll then be paid once you've secured the deal. So we are creating that within our facilitation framework, and we are digitizing it. Why? So that we are able to track who is this that is handling which investor, and if an investor is either mistreated or they lose their investment or they find themselves in wrong hands, we can trace and tell and know who is this that has misled the investor. So we've created that framework, and we will be inviting these players, different players within the investment ecosystem, to then be part of this journey, so that as Kenya Investment Authority, we play more of a coordination role than the really going down there and trying to do what the private sector can do.
Okay. We hosted your Principal Secretary for Investment here, Abubakar, some time back. Just remind us the targets that you have in terms of annual investment attraction. Just remind us the target.
We have a target of $10 billion.
$10 billion USD.
This year?
I don't know whether, you know, I can't contradict my boss, but we have a target of $10 billion.
We don't remember over 5 years.
Over a period of time, yes.
So it comes to about 2 billion, if we say over 5 years, 2 billion per year. That's 200 billion shillings. You did 74. In the just concluded financial year. So now you have another 200 billion to do. Where?
It's calling, having your work cut out for you.
Where?
But we have a strategy. Mm-hmm. I must say we didn't have a strategy before, but we now have a strategy that will allow us to package what we call brownfields. Brownfields are existing opportunities. Let's take, for example, this media house.
Yeah.
You're looking for an investor. This is a brownfield. It's an easy sell.
Mm-hmm.
We're able to come, sit, and look at the opportunity and go out there and say, within our business, here is the gap. Now, we are looking for an investor that can fill this gap.
Yeah.
Oh, that's an easy sell. You close it very fast. Greenfields are projects like Konza that takes time to then mature and land. Look at a project like Tatu.
Mm.
Tatu has both brown and greenfield. So we want to focus more on brownfield. Look at existing opportunities that can be used to tap investment.
Mm.
And the privatization commission has started. Some of these companies that are privatizing are examples of brownfields that will then help us land investors. But just to be honest with you, as a country, we must land investors if we are to create jobs for these million young Kenyans that are not that are struggling. Can I just say one more thing?
Yeah, as we wind up.
A few years ago, you would see a huge number of Kenyans working towards industrial area because the industrial area was thriving. We had factories actually manufacturing. What we have done is to close those factories and build godowns for products to be shipped to the country. We must reverse that. If we do not reverse that, then we will not be where we need to be as a country.
Thank you. Jean Chepkemoi is the Managing Director of Kenya Investment Authority. Thank you for joining us. Next time, we'll hopefully start on time.
Be nice.
I have more time.
This is the Situation Room, the only way to start your day.